One way to define behavioral design is kind of by some form of way of saying that it's a practice that systematically designs for behavior change. So systematic in that it's very process-driven, and behavior change is the outcome. It's really the most important thing that we're designing for. Another way to kind of think about behavioral design is to think about what are the key components. I come from behavioral science and behavioral economics, but there's also quite a bit of data science involved and quite a bit of design. Within each of these, but for example, in behavioral science, there's lots of components. It's neuroscience, it's decision science, psychology, sociology, and so on. But I really want to hone in on and focus on the design part, because I'm guessing a lot of people here, maybe you that I'm speaking to on the other side of the screen, is coming from that background, design. And that is fantastic, because it means that you have a head start. We call this the endowed progress effect. It's a shitty name that basically tries to describe this concept where you give someone a feeling of a head start. It can be having a stamp card where there's two stamps already kind of pre-stamped. So, okay, there's 8 stamps for free coffee, but there's already 2 pre-stamped. So I'm a little more likely to kind of feeling like I can complete a stamp card. Same thing here. A design background is probably one of the best ways to start a behavioral design career. And if you have that, good for you. That's a really, really good start. And when we get into behavioral design, one of the things I'm going to come back to quite a lot today is the idea of that it's a process and not a quick fix. So it's really about trying to put the process to work and use both science and design as a process for solving for behavior change. And as an example, how would the behavioral designer think? Well, consider an onboarding. It's not working as well as we want. Some people are not finishing it or not signing up for the thing we want them to do. And then we say, well, I heard this thing that, you know, works with this specific context is changing defaults. Maybe after you've done some research or literature review, you found that defaults very likely could work here. So you add some difference. A box that was kind of pre-ticked was non-ticked now or vice versa. And you see, is this going to improve the thing I wanted to do? No, it didn't. No results, no difference. So what did we learn here? Are defaults overrated? No, not really. The main thing that a behavioral designer really thinks about here is how well do you understand the context? Just because this tool didn't work in a certain context doesn't mean the tool isn't useful. It probably means that we're not understanding the context well enough. And that's really, really, really what we want to do. We want to really dig into that context, really understand what is going on and what explains kind of why this didn't work. And that in many ways is the challenge, is to really see how well can we understand the users that we're trying to design for, the product that we have, and the environment that exists within. And how that interplays is kind of really the three things that a behavioral designer will spend a lot of their time to really trying to get into. So behavioral design takeaway is the science of basically understanding the context, really trying to get into that context.